She's going to get
Okay, we are red. Red is on.
All right. Today is Thursday, December 28th, 2017. The time is, 4:48 or so. Let this meeting of the Tilton Board of Selectmen now come to order. Please let the record show that Ashley has not joined us as yet, but I believe she's on her way, right?
Yes.
Isn't tonight the night she was going to go get that car? All right, let us stand in pledge allegiance to her.
With allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Minutes. Minutes of 2:14.
Of when?
I mean, December 14, I'm sorry.
Valentine's.
12. Moving right along. Did we ever find out about the $400 envelopes?
That's a Tim question.
Is Cindy still here?
Oh, no, she looked down. We did not find out.
Accept the minutes of Thursday, December 14th, as written.
Second. All those in favor of the motion on the table, please signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. That is extension. The motion carries. Okay. We have a finance report.
I think it's doors.
Hmm?
Do you have a finance?
He's got 7 minutes.
I don't have one.
We'll see if the ring on the printer. Well, let's take a look at the DOT and their request for us to remove that parking space. Anybody has that?
That's like two spaces.
Well, Was it there before they put the park in? I think so. No, I see this day, so... Well, those two spaces are there before they put the park in. The space with the corner in it, I'm sure, but that's the one they're asking us to move, right?
2011, it was six spaces. See the dates here?
So then I must remove the one with the car in 2009, one in 2010, right? They just want that one?
Yeah. Move the seventh space, yes.
Is it ideally no more than six spaces should be on Main Street?
Right, so if you...
So it's wheel and deal, if they're gonna give that up, what are they gonna give us?
It is, because when you take a right and turn, even a school bus, it's difficult. Somebody's parked, you can't make that turn, you have to leave the city to pass.
We both wanted a crosswalk over the Riverfront Park, the Winter Street corner. You can see that that must be paying even for regular traffic.
I'll motion that we take the seventh space out.
Second.
Any more discussion, John?
Parking space, I should say.
No, I was just noticing, if you look where the first space starts, Brooklyn in front of the T-Hop, we actually slid that up a little bit and squeezed in the space, so next year when we do our...
We have six spaces instead of...
We could have six, but we, it might be better, maybe we can make them a little bigger or something like that.
I think we'll...
Lay them out a little bit better.
I think we'll end up with six spaces still and have that space in front.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
All right, so the motion on the table is to remove that seventh space as per the photo dated 9/11/2017. Type of motion?
Yep, that is.
So what's the date here? 9/11/2017. All right, all those in favor of the motion on the table, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, abstentions, motion carries. Would you please notify Bill Rollins that we will...
I'll talk.
As soon as weather permits.
We should have rent provided the black meeting over.
It's moving Christmas trees around.
We really, that's weather permitting though, that black, right? Am I not?
Something can run, no.
Hey, we don't have to...
Could they, as soon as weather permits, just take some white, even if it's spray paint in a can and hash out?
Yep.
You mean black?
No, I mean hash.
No parking, hash.
Put hashes in there, like it's a loading zone. I think that's a loading zone symbol or something.
So then you're gonna have trucks parked there loading with buses and trucks trying to turn, that's...
What will they do anyway? Well, they can take some black spray paint and paint it.
You just take black and paint over the white part.
I just don't think you're gonna be able to get it out of there until spring, really.
You probably not.
Well, and also that really wouldn't prevent people from parking there.
Unless he has an idea that we'll remove it quicker.
Just let him know what needs to be going.
If he has a grinder, that would be great.
Okay, got it.
Ask him to get it out.
It's the thermal paint.
Then you grind the paint off and you'll have the white from the grinding off the asphalt, so it'll still look almost like lines.
Yeah.
Just leave it till spring and we'll take care of it then.
No parking. Okay.
Oh, I can't tell.
Do you have a finance report yet?
I can't read it.
You ready?
Finance.
Yeah, okay, I better look at my facial expressions.
Take two.
Now, should that be facing, is that facing the board?
It doesn't matter.
Oh, it doesn't, okay. So is the sound going to pick up enough?
We get heated enough, it will.
Oh, that would never happen.
Nope. Not tonight, not.
Yes.
Hope so.
She claims today.
So I really do want you to help me write a farewell.
Yeah.
I want some words.
Right in the front.
Oh, that's right there.
Yes. Thank you.
Right.
I've got a Barrett's at home.
And then, oh, I see.
Are we getting that for the 2020 snow season?
That's it.
The body will follow once completed.
Well, I didn't have a lot of time to write this.
Why are we really pushing funds for something?
I can appreciate that I'm flat out this time of year. So I'm surprised that the toner isn't running in your hands. All right. So anyway, just my first item. I request to the trustees for reimbursement of projects that we've done during 2017. I've enumerated them in the along with the letter that's in the to-be-signed folder, if you please sign that. We're taking two items, reimbursing ourselves two items that the board had already approved out of the Roads, Streets, Bridges, Sidewalks Fund, and then the other item. I was hoping to do the entire truck and body at the same time, but we'll do the truck now and reimburse for the body once we have it, once the body's done. So, but we've paid for the truck, so we should request that money. So that's item number one. Item number two. So all these are the items as requested that I've had listed, with the exception of the carpet, which I didn't have in time for last week's report. But I did attach the Mango proposal and the Home Beautiful proposal to the back of this. And the first item, you may have seen, and I hope you had a chance to read, the town planner's memorandum on the Ironworks product and how he envisions that integrating and helping out the town, integrating with the land use department. And he's here to answer any questions on this, because he is an expert in the software at this point. and I can address some of the items that came up prior. In the agreement, there are protections for our data and being able to have our data exported once we stop, once we cancel the service. It's under data ownership. All customer data remains the property of the customer. The customer can request data electronically or on disk upon cancellation of service agreement. And we discussed, I believe, adequately the other attachment items that would go on to it. So one thing I do have that you do not have copies of, just so that you have an appreciation of the negotiation process that we went through. The original quote from them was $3,500 for the community development package and $3,600 for site and data conversion, along with a $2,000 citizen engagement, for a total of $9,100. So we are not doing the citizen engagement piece, but the amount that we've brought them down from $7,100 and $3,200 is pretty considerable. So I did want to just make note of that. I do have an agreement, if the board wishes to go forward with this, that we can sign today and we can pay for this year. We do have money in the budget for it. You will note that it's really difficult to tell this time of year exactly what we're going to have available to us, but I feel comfortable with the number 22,000, which I have at the end of that first paragraph. So this is well under that amount. And as I said, the planner's here if you have any questions for him.
Okay.
Yeah, I had a bunch of questions 2 weeks ago. Did you get those questions? And I asked so that I wouldn't be brought to the meeting without time to review those, to make a decision on this. I think everybody remembers that.
I know you had a question about maintaining the data, right? Whether we would own the data.
And, well, where it would be stored, security of it, public access to it, what type of encryption, what type of format it would be stored in.
Okay.
And we don't have all of those answers. It is a relational database format. They did enumerate that they back it up twice weekly and offsite once weekly. It's a hosted product, but I don't have the specifics of those other questions, and that's my fault for realizing.
One of the things is, you know, is this all completely 100% all public information that anybody could have any of this information given to them?
No, I mean that's not the way it's given to it. You know, it's there are permissions built in, and I don't know whether, I'm not sure that they have a way that you could essentially make the system available to anyone in the world. But they have indicated that by, you know, what if we sign with them, there's an unlimited number of, you know, subscriptions or however you want to put it, registered users that we can add. So we can make it essentially as public as we want for the town, I think. You know, as far as just going onto our website, you know, let's say if you're in
like
Korea or something.
Like the actual data that's in there, if it's inspection reports or they could have some legal implications or anything like that, is that all public information or is that part confidential?
I think it's held, it's really controlled by us, how many permissions we want to provide. As far as, you know, right to know law, I think, yeah, it's probably public. I mean, we don't have some, you know, 91A exclusion that we could list as to why we wouldn't share things with people. But as far as people just, you know, it's not going to be something that anyone can just log onto any computer and then be right into our system.
Any of this information that's stored on there was accidentally released out to the public. Could it be damaging to somebody?
The health officer reports are not non-public. So if I was using it and putting in my reports would be in there. They're not non-public reports.
Names or anything like that?
No, because there's no Social Security or birth dates. I mean, all that information. So all the information in my report as far as the address is already in our tax cards, avatar, this, you know what I mean? It's already out there. So any information that I'd have that was non-public would be in my notes, which wouldn't be in the system.
It would kind of be similar to the Avatar program where there are certain people that have more permissions than other people within the town hall. We as selectmen have permissions to go into a certain depth of it, but then Joyce and Cindy, and Cindy has more permissions than Joyce, and I think that, correct me if I'm wrong, but that's very similar to what you would set up, that we would have.
I think what John's pointing out, and it's well pointed out, that if my reports were non-public, when they went into that system, they may not be protected as non-public,
right.
And that may put us in trouble.
Data breaches are a big problem
there
over there, and we don't have the information I was asking for is, you know, about the server, whose server is it? Are they sublighting up the servers? Is this stuff on their own servers? What type of protection is being done to prevent information from being shared with the public or accessible by the public? What is the security system that they've built into their system for doing that? Because it won't be stored on our site.
Right.
Yeah, so we don't control it. What legal ramifications could have if we store all this information off-site in goodwill, but the other company released it?
I don't know of anything that happens in building permits that qualifies as confidential, actually. I can't think of anything at the moment. The only time we've ever sort of touched on confidential materials was the question of whether some of our exemptions and credits and exemptions in assessing were public, but it turns out those are public. So really nothing we do in land use winds up, we don't have the right to keep any of it private anyway. I'm not saying that, you know, we should just say, who cares who can hack into our system, but I don't know that there's anything super sensitive that we could stand to get in serious trouble for if it got out. Yeah.
Now, the other thing was in the fire department, there's modules in there that the fire department would enter information into.
Yeah.
I asked if we could get some kind of confirmation that they would agree to use the software.
Oh, okay.
It was a big saw that their inspections and their stuff would be incorporated in this too.
Well, they could be. I mean, whether they used it or not, it would be beneficial for Town Hall to use it. It was me that suggested, because of the housing inspections, that it might be a complete history of a property if we got life safety inspections in there as well.
Have you approached fire to see if they would be willing to?
I talked briefly on the sidewalk with Tim a while ago, and he thought it sounded, he was really curious and interested in it. But I don't see, I mean, so his inspection reports are sent to Alan, myself, and so even if he didn't enter them himself, they're sent to us,
and we
could enter them.
Digitally sent to us.
Digitally sent to us.
Yes, he sends us a PDF copy via the email, Al and I, and then we do the same thing with ours, so that we all know what's going on with the one property.
How many hours would this take for us to get all of our information into this? In other words, I mentioned that trying to look for some information, it can, at one point, took like half an hour to retrieve owner's information and stuff like that. As we know, when we purchase the software, it does nothing.
Right.
The software doesn't actually do anything because there's no data in it. Nothing. Software is only as good as the data and the information that you put into it.
Mm-hmm.
What type of estimate are we looking at before we would have, you know, all the information to make it usable?
Well, I guess it's not exactly the way I look at it, so I'll have to sort of bear with me here as I answer. I think that it's going to be useful right off. Let's say it's a blank database and a building permit comes in and we want to start our system where the land use technician is on the leading edge of entering the building permit. So on day one, that first permit, as far as, you know, I'm saying, okay, this system is working for us now. She'll get that permit entered and essentially we'll be, you know, we'll start building our database. Now, I don't think it'll actually be like that, where on day one it's an empty database. My understanding is that we can send certain data to iWorks, to their staff, and they'll get us set up. I guess there will be some decision that we have to make as to how much data we want to pump in there right at the outset versus, you know, we have the data, we know we want to move into a system where we're tracking building permits better. You know, we could essentially say, you know, January 1st, 2018 is the beginning of data being accumulated in the system, and then sort of go from there. I guess it's up to us. It's not necessary that we fill the system with all of our existing data before we begin using it.
So essentially it has no use until we put something in.
I don't think so, because
if you got this software package, what could it tell you before you put any data in there?
Well, I can tell you what they said to me is, so for me to immediately start using it, because I asked a similar question when they were showing it to me, I have created forms that I use when I do an inspection. So I would send them copies of my forms And then they would send me or create forms for this system. You know, in other words, this is what I want to collect, and I don't care what format it's in and how it's structured. They would structure it so it works in their system. They'd send it back, and then I'd start using those forms, and boom, it'd go in the system.
That one for each form is used. Now, originally, we talked about this a couple years ago, about creating a database, scanning all of our stuff in, so that when a building inspector form is filled out, or any of these other things, that we would be scanning these in and creating files for each property for having those. What happened with that? Why did we not proceed with that? Or we would have, let's say, a lot number, and in there you could look into the files and you'd have all the files with links.
We do. We have that.
And why?
And we're doing that.
But we're doing that. We have been doing that. And we have it on our own network, and it's backed up.
And the paper copies are in the property record card file of the building permit. I've seen her filing building permits.
Right, right. Yeah, I mean, so we do, we have a, Tim set us up with a whole, drive basically for parcels, and so we have the ability under map and lot number to file, so we're scanning documents as they come in, notices of decision, deeds. And so that's happening. We're also using the Avatar system. We used to just enter building permits. Now Sheena's entering environmental permits, notices of decision from land use cases. So we are doing that.
By lot and parcel.
Yeah.
Or by map and lot.
And you know, I think there's a case. Someone could say, as far as simply collecting data, we can easily do something other than this iWorks. And we can do something in-house, and this isn't unique. It's not the only opportunity to do this. I think where this really stands out, yes, it does collect data. It does a really good job of collecting and organizing data. But it also, and perhaps what makes it, again, makes it stand out, is that it organizes our work, and it helps us work more collaboratively. So as I was saying, like, to me, it's going to be beneficial on that first day. Whereas, you know, for someone who's simply looking at it as a database, no, it would be almost useless on the first day. But to me, as someone who's trying to organize the work of the land use department, it allows us to really put Sheena in the position we want her in of entering, of initiating that building permit process. And now you're creating this digital record that's accessible by Tim Joubert and by Catherine and by Al and by me and by you and whoever else we want to have. And so as that building permit process is executed from you know, initial filing of the permit all the way to issuance of a certificate, we have that ability to monitor, because we had concerns, you know, we've talked about concerns in the past of a very opaque building permit process where nobody really knows what is going on. You know, no one's aware of what building permits have come in, and until the building permit is executed and entered into the Avatar database, there's no way for anyone to follow it now. With this, things would be transparent and easy to follow the whole way through. So it would help with you, people interested in sort of monitoring land use office processes, and also it would be useful for the departments who need to work together.
Just, you know, the 11th hour spending on something that seems so important that I asked 2 weeks for information about, and we're here 11th hour, last minute, to spend something that's going to encumber funds to the taxpayers basically for eternity on something that, this is all I got on it, it's stated today. I can't agree with it. It's not the way I do business. I review things, I make sure things are, you know, security, and it's safe, and I don't feel comfortable enough that I know enough about it that I could say it could be good, it could be something of things, but that's just my. I think we really need things like this. We need to wait and present them on a more timely basis so that we have time to look at it. I think that Pat might have looked at Catherine, but there's Ashley and Peter too, that could have been in the back.
I think I reached out to all selectmen, possibly not Peter, I apologize, Peter, trying to set up webinars. pretty well.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I didn't get anything on that. Same text message. Yeah. But, I mean.
They had me look at it, not as a selection, but as a help officer, on how would the help officer use it.
This is something I had brought up originally when this was being discussed during budget as well. So this goes back into the October timeframe, September, October.
This is the information that's dated.
Yes.
12/28/2017. Kind of, it's last minute purchasing. I can't agree with stuff like that. I'm sorry.
I don't disagree with the questioning and your train of thought here, except that I do disagree that it's a last minute spending, because we have talked about this in the past, and when we were looking at setting up the land use office at the beginning, when Dari came on as town planner, and then we said, well, okay, listen, we're going to get a technician and so on and so forth. One of the goals was to organize that office, and one of the goals were to look at software, whether it be in-house or elsewhere. And that's been months ago. And then when Sheena came on, September, October, around and that, we again talked about it again. So this is sort of like, okay, now we found the right one. We have an IT tech director that came to us, along with the land use director, the land use planner, and town planner, and said, I've looked at several. This is what I've seen. I've incorporated the health officer in the code enforcement officer. We've all looked at it, and out of the ones that we've looked at, this one stands out, and these are the reasons they stand out. So I kind of in the back of my head for months now have known that somewhere along the line, whether it be this year if we had the money or next year, we would be looking at software to better organize the land use office. But I do agree with some of the questions you're asking.
So Ashley, you can probably tell by the conversation we're discussing the iWork system again.
Mm-hmm. And you know what the whole thing says, if you look third paragraph, I thought it was a system we're building ourselves. And that's what that, you know, that's just and databases, I've worked with databases, and that these are built in house that don't have these $3,000 a year never ending fees, and the data would be stored on site. And we'd have control of it and know where the cloud is and the other terms of it.
Well, I think to have an appreciation for it, I think you'd have to see it, particularly with the specific questions. You need to see the functionality, and because there really is a process flow to it. It's more than just a database, more than data elements. It is the ability to set up whole workflows, which will assist land use and help us make sure that we don't lose important checklists, that multiple people know where things are, as they're working through the land use department or the planning process, and it helps to incorporate the other entities that need access to the information, such as fire. And I do believe, having worked in an ancillary capacity with the health officer and code enforcement officer, that fire is very interested in working with us with our data. There's been evidence with the coordination with health.
I specifically asked 2 weeks ago to talk to him, see if we can confirm that. Mm-hmm. And today, I just asked that. We said, no, we don't know.
I'll take responsibility for it, because, unfortunately, it's just... it just didn't get done. So,
Ashley, do you have any questions you want to ask about it?
I'll just say, and I know I'm late right now, but I feel like John almost rushed into it. I don't see, I understand we want it, if we're going to do it, it's kind of monetarily we need to do it now, but I don't think that we need to do it now. I feel like it's something that can wait, especially just getting a new computer program at my job and getting surprises and all these things that you don't anticipate, and it's very overwhelming, and it's a big commitment. You know, it's not a one-time fee, it's a annual fee, and I don't blame Dari, you know. I know I didn't get to see that presentation on it, but, you know, I don't blame myself either, like, 2 weeks out that I didn't get to see it. I would prefer to wait and make sure that we've looked at every other program. Does that mean we, you know, and change Avatar? Because I know you said that this is linked with Avatar. I don't know. I want to see every option. I want to know every detail before we invest in this. Just knowing what, at my own job with a new computer program, knowing the, I guess, complications or, you know, unanticipated events that can happen. And when you're investing in a system like this, it's, I mean,
right.
You're telling me about it, but are you for it, or are you just...
No, absolutely. Yeah, I actually looked at an older version of this about maybe a year and a half prior to our planner joining the town. And at the time, I didn't feel like we could really make use of it because we just didn't have the manpower internally to make use of it. So we didn't have a planner, we didn't have a land use technician at the time. And it was a little premature, but I liked it very much. And when Dari joined and became the town planner, I had amassed some different contacts of people that were, you know, that had software solutions in this area, and so I had some contacts, and I know that people have contacted Dari since he's been here. So as he went through the process of looking at all these things, he found that this was, you know, the most adequate, you know, the best solution for us. And he and I went through and mapped out, you know, flowcharted from a very high level how we would do something internally, you know, what we could create, how we could do it. And as people that have really looked at what I've done technically here, Joyce could tell you, other people could tell you that I write a lot of programs that do things that help out in small ways here or there, or help things, you know, along for efficiencies. But this is a much larger undertaking in that, and it's not that it can't be done, it's just that as it grows and grows and grows, and as we add more things on and you know, the support and extending it to the point where, you know, where it would have the function of something like this would really be a huge, huge amount of time. So if we're trying to go through the whole, you know, almost a, it wouldn't be a replication, but maybe 70-80% of the functionality, perhaps, or 60% of the functionality. It would be a massive undertaking in Dari's part and my part to kind of get it there.
Are there consulting firms or like subcontractor type companies that would come in and do that for us, and then we still own it?
Way more money.
Sure, but you're talking about...
But see,
you know,
I guess I'm not prepared to decide on that tonight. If I have to decide, my answer would be no. Not because I don't believe you've invested and done the research, but I don't feel like... I mean, I think it's going to take a lot more than a like quick meeting. I need to see that this is like something that we need, that's going to benefit us, that is the best option out there. Because I think like not owning the stuff, it's almost like the more we invest, we're relying on them now. And then it's like we can't get away from them.
Well, and
because they would have all the information.
We do.
No, we own the information. We own that. We can drop out at any time and ask for our data.
But then we wouldn't have it organized.
But we do have a lot of things that we rely on like that now. Where, I mean,
I don't like that.
Well, we have infrastructure things like Amazon S3 service and Glacier, which we use for compressed encrypted offsite backups. We've got Google and the whole Google Sphere that we use for not just email, but also Google Drive and Calendar. And a lot of the programming I do is in Google App Scripts, which is a JavaScript-like thing that makes use of, we use it extensively in a lot of things. So those things are things that we're paying for, you know, repeatedly. They're not expensive, but, you know, it's something that we're relying on. We're relying on that environment. If we were a Microsoft shop, we would be paying Microsoft licensing fees you know, over some period of time. There are very few things where you just pay once and then you're not paying anything
after. Right, but expensive is relative.
Right, but Oracle, if we were to have our relational database, Oracle would be way overkill, but even with open source database, you're still going to have security patches, you're going to have updates, you're going to have all kinds of things that are going to require maintenance and personnel time. And that personnel time, particularly when there's a conflict in, say, the security or the data integrity, that can be really dicey, because if it's not done properly, you can end up losing data. You can be hacked internally. You could have all kinds of things go wrong. And so the benefit of something where it is it's a cloud-based system, which is what this is. So updates are automatic, if you will. In other words, there's nothing that we're going to load. It's preserved for us. And there's a trade-off, but most consultants for programming and that sort of thing would chew up the amount that this would cost us over the course of a year within about a day and a half, probably, of true consultant time. It's that expensive to do that sort of thing. But that's not to say that, you know, as Daria said, I mean, we can approach it, do the best that we can internally. I mean, we could do something like that. It's just that we feel like we, that functionally speaking, it is really a robust system. It gives us a lot of options. It is something that can start with right away. And that on all that scanning that we've done, John, in all the folders and everything, all that is not wasted, because we can take those and load that up into the system. We can also export and do quarterly all the tax cards that we have, exported from Avatar into this. So it's not, that activity is a wasted activity, but, I understand it. I think if you were to have seen it, there'd be more of an appreciation for what it is. Because it's more than just data storage.
I guess part of the thing is, like you talk about Oracle and Google and Microsoft, but this is iWork, IWORQ. Mm-hmm. There's not a lot of credibility behind there for spending $3,000 a year putting all of our taxpayers' information onto something that's stored on the cloud. We don't know if they actually own the cloud or they sublet the storage of this information out. Or the security levels from a company that I've never even heard the name, so I just can't jump on board though confidently.
The other locations in New Hampshire? Is it
Alton and Keene, I think. Is it Nashua? Yeah, and Alton.
Right.
And one of them was using Avatar for their permitting, and they were very happy to switch over to this.
Well, I'm in favor of it.
Peter, any comments?
Yeah, we only have so much money and we've got more projects, so is there any sort of priority as to what we'd like to do first and foremost, like carpeting in the town hall that every year I've been on is always on the list? Are we ever going to kick that dead horse, or is it going to every year be on the list?
So what happened? I was wondering if it would be possible to do with what we have as estimate for the town hall, and at least get something started and get the hallways done with the tile. At least get that started, and then maybe do the warrant article for the rest.
Well, while we have the planner here, maybe it's a good time to discuss the mapping. You have your mail starting soon?
Yeah, well,
it's over there now.
Because we've been asking for that for ever since Sandy was here. Sandy was.
Yeah, I mean, I can say, so we'd like to move to using Avatar for our mapping. We had been using a service, another service that we were consistent, but they were doing an okay job. No significant complaints. However, we were getting charged for essentially almost anything. Like if we wanted, I wanted PDFs of our maps at one point. You know, this is an example of essentially not owning your data, and we were charged for those.
What were we being charged approximately from the other company?
What's that? Sorry?
What was the other company charging us?
It was very similar. I think the last year we were with them, it was the last time we got map updates, we wound up, I can't, is it right here?
I can tell you, but we don't have enough money in the 2018 budget for what we're anticipating the mapping to be. So in the past, it was we spent an average of $850 between 13 and 16. In 17, we spent 500, and so we budgeted 500 for 18, anticipating we'd do the same thing.
Remember, this company is willing to, Avatar is willing, whenever we find a mistake, to correct it without an extra charge.
Right.
Unlike the other company.
Right, and they'll send us maps as we change them, so there doesn't have to be a once a year, you know, oh, whoops, we missed it, we'll have to wait till next year kind of thing.
Does that include even changing the names of streets or adding streets to names?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if we pay for the mapping out of 2017, then the $500 can be used for printing and laminating the maps. Because I believe, if you recall, we're provided with PDFs of these, so they will do it for us, but it's going to be more expensive to do the same thing as opposed to taking it to Staples and just doing, what, 2x3, 2 foot
right.
by 3 foot?
Yeah, exactly.
Laminated
is like $16.
So the $500 would give us enough money to do the printing and laminating. And then in the 2019, we'll be sure to put in $1,250 for the annual cost and whatever we anticipate for that printer.
Right now we don't have anybody. We need to have somebody because there are mistakes in there.
Right.
Pretty glaring mistakes.
So what the ArcGIS was, what happened with that?
What happened with it?
Yeah.
What do you mean? We have GIS.
I know we bought some software and we're subscribed to it.
We actually,
GIS.
Free, for free we were using QGIS, which is actually pretty good.
What happened to ARC?
ARC, Johanna uses. I've never purchased it.
Conservation Commission, I think. And then
we gave it to Johanna.
That license went to Johanna.
Well, I'm glad. Actually, good question. What Avatar can also do, and what we should look at for the future, is to not only generate maps, but generate a shapefile. So you have a GIS layer that's very accurate. Right now, our parcel layer is created through a grant from the Department of Revenue Administration, and it's not very good at all. It's not accurate at all. Whereas if Avatar did this, they'd base it, you know, it'd be right on the, based off the CAD maps, it'd be right on the money, and it would also work into our Avatar system. There's a tab on Avatar for mapping, mm-hmm. and right now when you click on that, for us, it's blank. Now that whole function would essentially come alive. Yeah.
Now, could you put the, with Avatar, would we actually get a GIS, we'd actually get a photograph, or just the paper lines? I mean, would we actually have a visual, like when you look at Google Maps, you can see.
Right, you could actually, it's kind of neat, you can actually post the shapefile to a public website,
okay.
and then you can have a Google Map actually pull in, so
okay.
we could have a website where people.
You know, we use that all the time, but that would be
right. Yeah.
A bonus.
Yeah.
Major
yeah.
bonus.
Yeah, yeah.
because I'm forever trying to paste tax maps together with Google Maps, and
yeah,
if it was all in one spot, that would be wonderful.
Right. And
can we get our zoning lines?
Yep. Yeah, we can definitely do that, because once we have, right, that's easily done.
We have map and lot numbers you can read.
We need to really move on with the conversation.
So this is
upstairs.
This is 1250 for 2018.
For no, we would contract for it now and pay for it
out of 2017 money.
Mm-hmm. A 2018 cost that will cost us 1250.
Mm-hmm. Right. In other words,
we
pay the $12.50 now out of 2017.
Yeah, for 2018.
Covers all through 2018.
2018.
Yes.
So, well, so we're not signing a contract for multiple years.
No, that's correct.
Okay.
So moved.
We're purchasing maps for next year.
Right. Second motion is to go forward with the
mapping
service from Avatar for 2018.
For $1,250.
Any more discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion on the table, please signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries.
Thank you.
All
right.
Motion to go ahead with the iWalk software for $500 down payment, $225 per month, which was discounted from $3,000 up front, $300 per month. Suggested approval of $3,200 for 2017.
18?
To pay for 2018.
Second, any more discussion on this? My works. All those in favor of the motion on the table, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
Nay.
Motion carries.
Cameras. Can they wait for thank you.
Thank you.
Can they wait for a warrant? Or?
They can. They can.
Well,
I can tell you, just so I can bring you up to date, over the weekend, I had sent to the principal of Mango our requirements for town hall and also the PD, and I tried to get the PD proposal because I feel as though that's a higher priority.
Yeah.
But the there are two proposals here that pertain to town hall. One is with all replaced IP equipment, and that's the $12,175, and then on the backside is the hybrid system, which is part IP and part what we have, and that would be $99.80. And I would say this is a lower priority than our need at the PD right now. But as I thought before, you know, maybe these are a good thing to put in the warrant article and bring before town meeting.
You know, why would we bypass the budget committee when we put these types of things in a warrant article? We're bypassing the budget committee. We should put these in our budget, go to the budget committee and say, we're going to add this to our budget and this is why. And if they agree, then we've made a good pitch. And if they don't, then
can
we have another chance to go to town meeting.
But a warrant article, what's the people at town meeting?
Well, they also, they can know what at town meeting because of the budget, it's in the budget.
If you put it in the budget, it's in your operating budget. These are not regular operating expenses that we have every year. They're one-time things, and they qualify for being a special warrant article. That way, the people see it. The money can't be spent on anything else.
Well, that's a
good
point.
And it keeps your operating budget from spiking like this all the time.
I just feel like we bypass the budget committee when we do this.
One thing is the budget committee has to approve or
they would, you're right, they would yay or nay on the budget, on the warrant articles.
No.
It's still not the same. Anyway.
I would like to do that, but I would also like to have a discussion of the flooring, because the flooring has this discussion has been now 9 years in the making.
Yes.
I gotta tell you, I have.
It'd be nice to have Joyce take at least a couple steps on fresh carpet.
I'm gonna roll around.
I had a couple of phone calls on the cameras, and I have to tell you, there are people out there that watch our movies from the beginning to end. And I'm surprised. I know people snap in on them, but from beginning to end, there's people out there that watch it. And some very good points were made to me that it's a public building. Mm-hmm. Why would we even consider putting a buzzer on the handicapped entrance door to keep people from freely entering this building when they can come right in the front door?
I disagree with that.
And the other thing is it a violation? I don't know the answer to this one. Is it a violation of their privacy when we have them on camera?
As long as you post it.
Coming in and out of the building.
That's why we have notices saying that there is a video surveillance. We checked on this back when we did the front part, and we initially put our cameras on.
Our camera system is set up so basically you can watch somebody come in. Well, it used to be go to land use, come out, go to Tim's office, mm-hmm. come out, go to motor vehicle, mm-hmm. so you don't put their whole entire mm-hmm. business was conducted in town hall. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know, if there's someone sitting in the chair watching, just sitting.
I know, it just never been pointed out to me. And
as long as they know that there is a video surveillance.
I mean, why do we need to, and the other thing is, why do we need, this is me, why do we need to go beyond the entrances?
Mm-hmm. We don't, and I don't think that cameras will not prevent crime. We have cameras now. We don't have a problem with crime in town hall. The police department, certainly, like, let's get what we need in there, but, you know, if someone's coming in here to commit a crime, which we don't have a problem with at all, in years and years and years, it's going to be somebody disgruntled, there will be witnesses. If there's not witnesses, a camera would never prevent that. The camera, you know what I mean? It just doesn't make sense to me. And the buzzer doesn't make sense at all because you're going to let anybody in. So I don't see any like evidence-based reason for that. Especially since we don't have any safety issues.
Yeah, and if we have the entrances covered, then if somebody comes in, if somebody walks in here in the morning and say, oh, somebody broke into town hall, we're covered because we've got the entrances covered. Why do we need to go beyond that? Okay, I'm kind of agreeing with Ashley.
Chief, what do you think?
I'm just trying to think of when we did these, I think it was if there was no one downstairs, there was a meeting upstairs, you guys could
see
people
we did those, yeah.
coming in to the building. Mm-hmm. You know, I try to think of like reasons where you might go into like a soft lockdown if there was a robbery downtown and the suspect was outstanding downtown. I'd probably encourage all the businesses to go into like a soft lockdown, which means, you know, be very cautious who you let in the building, be aware that there's a robbery suspect on the loose downtown, that sort of thing, just like we do with the schools, we'll put them in lockdown. And if you don't have any ability to do that, I would probably want to post someone here if I could, you know, but...
If that were the case, we could lock the doors.
Yeah.
I mean, that is such a rare...
I think we did that once.
We did once.
Yeah,
yeah,
they were
robbed
next door.
Right.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I forgot about that. That was interesting.
I think the original request stemmed from the Joint Loss
mm-hmm.
Management Safety Committee,
mm-hmm.
and it was particularly about the second floor. Mm-hmm. It was that the first floor was covered, but the second floor isn't.
Right. Now that we had more staff up there, they would know what was going on down here.
Then rather than make the decision...
So is it to watch staff?
No, I think...
No, just to see who's coming up.
Rather than make a decision, can we make a commitment that we would actively get involved in the joint loss management concerns and see if we can't come to a resolve in the very near future, just to try to figure out
mm-hmm.
what their concerns are and see if we can come up with an alternate other than spending $12,000 on cameras.
Sure.
I mean, would that be a...
I agree,
asking the board, I don't know.
Let's hear from the experts, I guess. I mean, just in my knowledge, I don't think it's going to prevent anything. I don't think we have a problem here. We're not Walmart. There's no loss prevention. Even if, you know, something happens, there's no benefit to us to go out and catch a criminal that isn't here, that we don't have a problem with. You know what I mean? It just, it's a lot of money when we already have the cameras, I guess. Ideally, sure, but I think it's a wasted expense.
Well, like Pat said, maybe we can talk with the Joint Loss Management Committee and make, you know, have some firm, clear written procedures in terms of making sure that everyone, that when you're in the building, that they're aware where other people are, which would mean more communication, because there may be somebody upstairs and we don't even know it, or something may be going on upstairs, and make sure that we, I mean, right now, we have an intercom and a code that we can press if somebody is in there. So, but really get that written up and understood.
That's what will prevent injury.
And
communication, safety plans, policy.
Right.
Well, there is one thing. I just wouldn't bring it up to anyone in public, but I can think of one thing that the board should be aware of. But again, it's the likelihood of something is, it's probably a low likelihood, but it's a high risk. And
there's nothing we're going to do short of locking the doors, having a speaker out there that's saying, why do you want to come in and who do you want to see, and I'll send them down.
Well, I would, if you end up having a non-public and you have a minute, that
come
you
in
share
and
that
us.
Safety thing with yourself.
There have been instances where we've had groups that have been, that have become very volatile in over the 9 years, that we've had to call and have police come and just sit in case. And, you know, thank God nothing's happened, but it came pretty close on a couple of occasions upstairs.
Well, we had a fisticuff here one night. The planning board.
Yeah.
I asked them to go outside, and they very nicely did.
Just
and they continued
around
outside.
They
did
outside.
We called
a lot would happen, but that's at least once a year.
You know,
have something
they weren't
like
putting
that.
Anybody else in danger but themselves.
Right.
It was just kind of a roll around. So, but anyway, all right, moving
right
along.
So, we'll, Pat, we'll follow up with that.
All right, blow up.
Option two. Is that the one, Joyce? VCT tiles?
Well, ideally, I'd love to duplicate the tiles we have out front, but I like the idea of the slip resistant. Is that option two?
Yep.
Yeah. And I think that's what we may have been leaning toward last time.
Mm-hmm. Everything else seems to be about the same.
So does that mean, may I ask, does that mean that if they would take up the tile?
Yep. And
the take
lobby.
Up the carpeting
yep.
in these two hallways, mm-hmm. and they put down VCT.
Mm-hmm.
And that's $3,100?
Yeah, and it this does not include either the bathrooms. It doesn't include anything with the stairs.
No, not $3,100.
I think the bathrooms are in pretty good shape, aren't they?
Yeah.
You have to add the underlayment, which is $1,920. Labor to install material $938 and VCT Armstrong $3,100. That would be my guess.
Can someone quickly highlight what's the difference between 1, 2, and 3?
One is ceramic tile.
The other is VCT.
And the other one is VCT, which is up at the PD.
And that's between 2 and 3?
What? Well,
right.
You have.
And that's throwing me off. So that
yeah.
is supposed to be office offices.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And that does not include labor to remove everything out of the building, correct?
No,
none of them do.
No. But
so,
we have,
so you have we have an additional charge
yeah.
if
yes.
we have no.
Yes. We have a plan, and I have two movers that are interested in, and I sent them all the information, what the plan is and how we do it. Start on like a Friday, But prior to that, that employees in their offices will be responsible for moving all their personal items, anything that they can lift that's just personal items that they don't want to have disturbed. And also, this room would be the last room done, so people could put those things in here. And also, it should go fairly quickly. What?
Sorry.
No. You're the one that has the most extraneous stuff.
No, I was just, I didn't realize the numbers for option two went on to the second page, so you're really looking at 78.
Okay, so we start with the town clerk tax collector office, and that the movers would be here when the they were doing it, so they could move it out and then move it right back when they were done, and then go on to the next office and work their way around. And then this would also be helpful that when we're moving all of the, would do the land use office, I listed that as office number five, carpet that, because that would be really easy to clean out, and then move all the file cabinets back in there so that we're only moving those once, not twice. And then we can leave the copy machine and the folding machine and the postage machine right where they are.
Until the server and everything.
Until the server and everything comes in, and because that's got to all be rewired over in there, and that will be
difficult. Just for a real quick second, seeing as this is only one bid, I don't think we should be disclosing publicly these numbers, so that if this is what we want to do, we should have other people bid on these items.
Okay.
We have, and these are the ones, this is the one that came in.
Yeah.
We have three bids on
this. Yeah. Well, from before.
Yeah, we've had.
So that's exactly what I was going to say. We're talking about $20,000.
Yes.
We need to seek out other.
We've done that.
We've done that.
I don't see it.
And, well, I can pull that all out for you. And the Beautiful was the only one that would do it.
Yeah. And why is that? Why would.
The moving of equipment and.
Timing.
Yeah, and being able to do it on a Friday night and on a weekend.
It's not a clear job. It's not a clean job. It's not a come in. There's nothing in here.
I mean, I'd have to disagree with that.
And they were the ones
subcontractors that do commercial carpeting, that do hospitals, and you know what I mean? They.
I know, but they're doing it to accommodate our business.
But like, I'm talking about who did you? I guess I need to see a list of who you called. I don't know. And if we have other quotes,
they didn't quote.
I mean, I
am just saying.
They refused to quote.
They refused to quote.
Disagreeable.
They
I want to do this,
quote.
But
they
how can I do this with one company?
They would not quote. Will you go within the area? And they would not quote because they refused the job. They came in, walked around, did a walk around with Joyce, and they, you know, reputable people, and they
The floor show wouldn't even quote.
No.
Are they even still open?
No, they closed. They just said it was too much work. It was just too much work, and trying to do it while we're continuing
right.
that one day to keep
Doug
it open, and to do it on over a weekend,
yeah.
a Friday night.
My thoughts are, you know, we can go ahead with this. Let's not give out the amount. List what we're going to do, and at least send it out to a couple people with this list of things, without the amount, and give them the days to respond. But we could approve.
I don't want
to
do that again.
We could approve that we will get this, you know, the amount up to this amount.
In order to approve it, you have to contract according to what you have in.
In order to encumber,
you have to enter into a contract with them.
It's just
you can't just say, "Oh yeah, we'll get it done here." We've approved it by motion. You can't do that. You have to actually have a contract for work.
Knowing what we went through before, I just
this was the list I used in 2012.
But that's 4 years ago.
This was floor show respectfully declines.
Which they're closed. I'm not saying that this isn't maybe the best company. I can't make a decision based on one company quoting. I guess I need to see all these people defining. I want to say, yeah, let's do it, but I can't do that.
Okay. Then we'll do it as a warrant article. Special warrant article.
Yep.
Also, because I don't know the cost of the movers yet.
Yep. Well, let's get that all together then.
I have two people quoting on the move.
Okay, let's get it all together and...
Meanwhile, if Ashley has some additional people that maybe we can contact for bidding, we can get that done ASAP.
Well, we could call all these guys again and be like, it's been 5 years.
They won't do it. They've already said...
This is spent from 2012.
In 2012,
that's okay.
The job was too big for them then, it's going to be too big for them now.
Joyce will call.
Can we just...
But I just need to see that they have said, yes, we can, and like, that this...
Just have a list of what, we can decide what we want, option one, option two, or option three right now, and then we know what it exists of, and then we can say option two, which is all this stuff, and send it out to people, if they respond within so many days.
I do like the idea of the slip resistant, and I don't really like the VCT, but I really do like the slip resistant, and I think that's going to be more cohesive here in Town Hall, where it's a public place, than ceramic tiles, so I would go with option two.
I like option four. No effing rug. It holds mold, moisture.
Well, that...
It's a health trap.
Is this going to be...
No.
This is not going to be carpeted, correct?
I like...
No, this room is carpeted. I thought we said no.
No.
I thought we said no.
No,
we're going to go with the VCT.
Just the hallways.
I put it out for hallways.
All I could get with the hallways, I tried for everything.
I like everything too.
Then you can get your little area rug if you need a little carpeting.
Well, you don't have to worry about a dead body anymore. Silhouette on the floor.
That's true.
Why, how many have there been in the building?
Yeah.
Couple.
Spilled.
Well, but it kind of goes with the feel of the building. I mean,
you want to copy? Well, this hardwood floor upstairs.
What would be the con in having it all VCT?
It'd be very cold. It'd be very
noisy.
Clean. Cold.
What about
sterile.
Clean?
VCT is much easier to clean than
right.
The
right.
Private offices is just more comfortable and less noise. I could say in the public areas, yeah, you would want the tile. That's why we're doing the
so
hallways.
This is where everybody eats and has their lunch and everything. I would think that we would want that. I thought that was part of the discussion that we would have, you know, sort of like a VCT underneath here.
It was never planned to have people eat here. We were going to try and eat in the old room. We don't want to sit in the public.
Okay, so selectmen, option two right now that we have, but who would be in favor of having this area at least VCT as well instead of carpeting?
VCT at all?
I guess I'm not going for more VCT.
I don't know.
It's up at the tile, the vinyl tile.
Yeah, just like regular vinyl tiles.
Yeah.
Just a
VCT.
Material. And so the maintenance on it, I know we had an issue.
It's like we have up at the kitchen CNC room set.
And just has to be washed and stripped like a regular thing.
Yeah.
Oh, no, not this one.
And actually, the public
basement.
Here,
yeah.
Up through there.
But it's
not
slip resistant.
Ideal with something that could be bumped up or...
Including here?
Yeah.
But it's just regular.
The offices, I
and the offices with that.
Just
I like that.
Just because it's cozier.
You got a little bit more.
All right.
So that's all right.
So the conference area here
where
we're
decreasing
VCT
the mold population.
Consensus say this area with the VC go along with the hallway and everything with this, with the VCT non-slip, and then just the offices itself with carpet.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the 2-inch thick that you can walk around barefoot.
Shag.
Are you starting to believe in that?
That'll hide a lot of crumbs, that's for sure.
Look at, we made a decision.
All right.
What will that reduce the cost to?
So you're going to have to figure it out because you're also going
to
ask those other people.
This is option 3.5.
family, I think.
Yeah. So it's really option two, but you're adding VCT to this room.
Yeah.
And moving cargo. And all the offices too.
Okay, Joyce.
All right. Make a motion. Don't be with a motion.
All okay, right. I'll make a motion that we go with option two, except we're going to include this entire meeting room with VCT number four, entry and hall, and office area, material safety zone, blah, 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 slippery retardant, VCT Armstrong, right?
Blah, 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 pot, okay.
Just read number
the
four.
LAH.
Option two.
The LAH.
I'm already picking it up.
What about the little nook under the stairs? Do you want that to be carpeted or VCT?
VCT.
That's where Heather's office is.
Is that where you're going to eat?
Yeah, yeah, that's...
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
And number,
oh,
right.
Offload.
Number six.
Okay. Carpeting.
All right. Boop. You gained another one. All right. Well, second.
Yep, this is what I sent to the.
Does everybody understand the motion on the table?
I have an idea of what the order and then I listed.
Yes.
More or less.
What was going to be done.
Yes.
All right, all those in favor of the motion on the table, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, opposition, motion carries.
Yes!
I have the closest it's been.
I did.
I have just one last quick thing.
No, actually, you're making...
We still have the PD cameras.
I thought those were going into either Warren or Gold.
Are we
going
to do the PD cameras in a Warren article?
And option two, and now.
If we're moving this to the Warren article, are we move...
I didn't get a quote from them for the PD cameras.
Catherine, this hasn't been settled on the PD cameras. Are we putting that into a Warren article?
Yes, wait a minute.
Since we don't have a price.
Because we have a 50% BPM G.
That's what we just want to say.
EMP.
EMP.
We think we can get it matched.
And meeting materials.
Hey, Joyce.
They won't commit the file.
You know, they just say it should.
Afraid it comes all done.
But I just wanted to point out one quick thing on the budget. It's on the very front page. That's that we received the sewer commission's budget of $508,533. And, which is pass-through, so I added it to the
what's the
front.
Increase for?
Engineering. We actually got the...
As long as it's not sewer commission raises, I'm fine with it.
No, it's the commissioner's stipends.
That's what I meant. Who knew what I meant?
So I've added it to the expense on the cover page and also to the revenues, and the board would just... So signify there in a consensus with that.
Make a motion to accept the total appropriation of $5,723,122, which includes a $508,533 sewer pass-through budget.
That's right.
Second.
What number are you? Oh, you're on the budget.
He's had
three. Get the cookies away from this man. All those in favor of the motion on the table, please signify by saying aye.
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 Okay.
I've got a year or so without sugar.
That's all I have. Thanks very much. Happy New Year.
Happy
yeah,
year.
See you next year.
Okay.
Yeah, I've been good in the last year. I haven't had
I'm
many candy bars or anything.
Many. Okay, so not no good.
Very well. I'm
like,
are you looking at me?
All right. Non-public is on my list. Yeah, I would hire it, that's on.
Okay,
so
all
the
town
is
Do we want to
have the town administrator go ahead, because if we wait, I mean, we're going to have planning board people
in and out.
In and out.
I'm here tomorrow.
Prices, even if you look in the newspapers, companies that are looking to hire people to plow and dry. These maximums are probably closer, well, at least the 24s and the 26s. And I have the email that they sent me.
Hopefully, I'll be here.
Have you ever been operating with light?
What are we hiring for? A Leo or a Hio?
Well, they
Hio.
Do both. They do both. A Hio does both.
Why?
Leo.
Right. So,
why?
What do we need?
Why?
I thought that's what we wanted.
We have two CDL trucks.
And I thought we wanted a CDL.
And we have four non-CDL trucks.
I don't know. I thought he wanted a CDL driver.
A CDLB.
That's fine. Yeah. We already have four in with it there.
Are we public?
Five.
Yes, we're public. But I thought he wanted to... Okay. I mean, he still has to rotate. You may have one driver per truck, but you've got to rotate through.
Our job descriptions...
Okay, well, you can't have somebody like the storm we've been through that were, you know, 24 hours. You can't have somebody sit in a truck and drive for 24 hours. You could drive for, what, 10 hours maximum on a CDL, and then you have somebody else take over.
Our job descriptions say heavy equipment operator, light equipment operator. And in those job descriptions says you've got to drive a truck, and a CDL, list all the types of equipment that you can drive. And it also says in there that you also perform labor duties. And we call them truck driver laborers because we don't have graders. We have a loader and trucks, and we have a backhoe or had a backhoe.
So it looks like we're pretty on point with our pay.
Actually, we're very low.
You think?
Well, you look in the construction industry, we're very low.
But I'm looking at what this is. I don't
you
know
look at
who
municipal.
Did this.
I did. I contacted similar communities that have downtowns other than Wilmington. She's just, I had sent out a query and I know her, so she answered it. But the others are just so we could compare. They all have minimums and maximums. They have steps, with the exception of Northfield. Northfield just has ranges. They just do mins and max, and then they stick somebody in the range.
Why does Franklin only have Leo?
Because I asked what they had that was comparable to a truck driver that has to plow snow.
So they don't
That's
have heavy equipment.
Truck driver, that would be the equivalent. A truck driver Leo is what would be equivalent to what we have. I need a CDLV and drive a school is our people with a 6-wheeler.
You won't be driving that.
Do we need a Leo or a Hio? What do we need? What's our needs for our town?
CDLB.
And that is
driver,
what, which one of these?
We don't need a CDLB. You can get away with a DOT fiscal card because you can put them in the two F550s, the GMC, or the Chevy.
Public Works Director specifically answers the other.
Okay, so Brock, Kevin.
That's in our job description.
John.
But that's what he asked.
Willie and Robert all have CDLs.
Well, Robert.
He has a CDL, he's got a restriction, but he's working on, but he's got.
Do we have any automatics?
He's working on it. They're not restricted, they're not called restrictions.
Okay.
It's a restriction. It's a CDLB.
Yeah.
With a restriction.
Automatic.
He can only drive an automatic.
Yes.
So why do we have the HTO?
It's endorsed.
Why do we have the what?
We don't have the HTO for Franklin.
Because he didn't send me that. He sent of their job classifications, of their positions, he sent to me the equivalent of what we have for a truck driver that can operate loaders and backhoes and what have you and drive six wheelers.
So when you say that, to me, I'm hearing that's what we need. Is it not a?
No. Okay, what did Brock's ad say?
CDLB, it's a truck driver.
Okay. Did he advertise for somebody with a CDLB?
Yes, and we do that because both of our job descriptions say CDLB. That the board approved back when saying.
So really, it's only the HEOs that we should be looking at.
Well, some don't.
No.
No.
Doesn't matter.
We, you know, we really don't have heavy equipment.
Yeah, we do.
We really, no, we don't.
Well, you've got your.
You've got a small backhoe.
No, we don't.
And a medium loader, that's huge.
And a medium loader.
Okay, medium, you have a small loader. I mean, that's I get a bigger loader than that sitting in my backyard that I drive.
No, you don't. Not the Kawasaki, you know. The Case one maybe, but not the loader he's got.
Is new loaders bigger than my Ford?
Oh, yeah. It's
okay.
Probably double, yeah.
It's still
so
not big. I'm not talking
is
about my
HEO.
2120.
No, CDL is commercial driver's license.
Why are we talking about this?
Because this is, well, this is what's in front of me. This is how it's been organized. We're looking at LEOs and HEOs, and so.
All we're concerned with is we're looking for a truck driver.
Why? So why is it important to the town of Tilton?
They're trying to, because he wants.
I asked to have pay people. So the last time we discussed this, no one had any wages to compare it to. That's what was said. So that's why I said, well, could you do this? Because
Selectmen
asked for it.
What do you pay truck drivers?
So what's the going rate?
And they have to be able to know how to plow snow, and they have to have a CDLB.
What's the going rate?
Okay.
So
those are the going rates.
So the bottom line is Brock advertised for a CDLB driver.
Which has nothing to do with LEO or HEO?
No, this is just what they're paying.
Not really. I always hand those designations.
It's upstairs.
Upstairs. Thank you.
I can show you some heavier equipment.
Depends on what their actual responsibilities are within the town.
Also, larger departments do have it broken down.
Heavy and light.
Heavy and light. Our job descriptions are heavy and light.
So if we hired light, would that still be a CDLB?
Yes.
I don't see that we're too off target.
It's not, those LEO and HEO is ridiculous. For municipal, it's ridiculous.
Well, 2282.
It's ridiculous.
Our highest
one. LEO and HEO is ridiculous.
No, it depends. If you're a larger municipality, you could.
If I was Manchester or Nashua, it'd still be ridiculous.
No.
Well, in Northfield, you had to be an HEO, a heavy equipment operator, to run the grader. That's a
running a grader is unique unto itself.
Right.
That really doesn't have anything to do with HEO and LEO.
Pipes
it's
used
grader.
To train their grader drivers.
Yeah.
In Northfield, we get our roads graded for free.
Right. Grader driving is something else.
So someone that's a heavy equipment operator.
So at this point, what you're looking at is.
I'm just giving you the data they sent, the mins and the maxes, and I kind of tried to sort them by from.
What are we trying to do here?
$20 to $23.
Higher.
To see what the range is.
And we advertised for 19.
16 to 19, right?
We did not advertise any rate.
We didn't give a rate.
No.
And what did we budget for this job?
We discussed 16 to 19.
Okay. And looking at,
I thought Tim said we budgeted 19.
That's what I thought.
And looking at the person Brock, that was his first pick, that would qualify within the job description, his previous experience and pay rate, I think we're well within the range. And I think. Was he asking for 20, the specific person? There's one thing with...
Something that or more, 2021, you have to try to issue with.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Brock will be in next week, so...
Well, and the thing to consider, these municipal rates may be lower than what's out there in the private sector, because we offer benefits. I mean, our benefits alone are what, $3,000?
So Brock's not even here, so I thought he was gonna be here this week, but he'll be here next week?
He's asked to be on the...
So, that's just a quick and giveaway to Guy, what you did camera. Randy still hasn't given me the estimate, I've talked to him again, I sent him the scope of work. He's promised me to get me something next week.
Okay.
Okay? Carpet bits we did, oh, and the to be signed is the transmittal. I know you had already signed a transmittal before for Health Trust. The reason you have to re-sign it is because they are going to be managing the health reimbursement account. It's still gonna be benefit strategies, they're very similar to like Health Trust contracts or Anthem to manage everything. But it's all gonna be on one website for the employees to access, and it's all on one bill. Plus, Health Trust is not charging us the monthly administrative fee, and they're not charging us a salary fee.
Nice.
So that's done. Office relocation, they started with the door. And also, I just need your clarification again. Did you say I could order a door window for the sewer, or ordered me that from last week?
I think that was a general consensus, but we can bring it up again. So you're talking about the door at the foot of the stairs, to go upstairs. We want a window in it, and it was discussed, because John, you weren't here last week, was because when you open the door, if there's somebody behind it, you can't see him, so you're coming down the stairs, you push the door open and...
The door that's in that hollow floor, door that's barely hanging on there, you should have a proper door on there.
But it is locked.
Yeah, go get it.
Is that the consensus, everybody, to replace that with one with the windows, or instead of slamming into people?
Okay, let me do the quick one. Kino, I called Candy again. She still has us down tentatively for the 4th, but she was supposed to call me back today because they were having a staff meeting, because they are like being asked to go out to all these communities. And the SB2 towns really get first crack at it, because they have to be first. So she said she's still shooting for the 4th. I checked my email before we started the meeting, she didn't answer, so that's Kino. I was able to get in touch with, and John, you weren't here last week. This is the parcel that we're talking about. This is a piece of landlocked property that the town took by tax deed in 2013. Okay, and a butter has asked to, to purchase it. I was able to reach the former owner's daughter, who happens to be the town clerk tax collector in that town. And she said she has no interest in the property because it's landlocked. Her mother passed away in 2014. I asked her, do you know the history of the property? How was it that she acquired it? And she said she didn't know, but she knew that her mother owned it because it came back. And I have the original deed and subdivision, but it doesn't really tell me anything.
It is strange.
There's no right of way to another piece of property or nothing, just...
Nothing.
Mainland.
This is from 1932.
I mean, theoretically, there's nothing, there isn't any property that's landlocked because you're in right tax, that's your property. However, building a road or something else is property.
Oh, this one, yeah.
Yeah, this is a little bit bigger to look at. Because it goes on to two tax maps.
But it is strange.
And we do have the original deed, because it's one of these... what year is it? 1947, where you have parcels from different towns shown as separate tracts, all of them deed. So to check and see what town it's in, And then this is the description, which was originally conveyed in 1908 to this one, which is related to Clara Towns, who is somehow related to Taylor's.
I mean, what was it, the Town Pound or something?
I don't know. Is any of those names up in there? So anyway, and, but she said, she said, go ahead and sell it to the abutters. So, the board last week asked me to put together what the amount is, and I believe I emailed that to everybody. Did you follow that?
Yep.
I didn't understand what it was, so I, now I know what we're at.
And if you hold this up, here's Winter Street. You can see, this right of way?
Yeah, this is.
See this right of way?
Yeah.
This right of way is this right of way. Going to this piece, which says Town's property. This is 74 feet, this is Stevens, this is lot 26. This would be lot 30, I'm sorry, lot 29. And then Stevens would be lot 30. Then you get over here and it's like, what happened here?
14.64 rods.
It's a big one.
Rods 15 and a half.
So what is owed to the town on?
Not a whole lot.
Just some of it.
Very little. Well, it's only assessed at, in 2013, it was assessed at $200. And then 14, 16, and 17 was $100. If memory serves me, with the 10% penalty, it's $298 and some cents. So my recommendation to the board is that we, offer it to the abutters. And the highest bid.
$300?
Well, they may want it paid more. And since we've waited more than 3 years, the town gets to keep the money.
Okay. I like this. Bidding war. You're going to offer it to all the abutters?
To all the abutters, and we get a set date, return a sealed bid. To me, that's the only way that's fair.
With the authority to refuse all bids? Okay. What do you think?
And they're responsible for all registering and transferring of ownership of schemes and all other.
Well, that would be in the what we get for. I mean, I would not accept anything lower than $500.
Okay.
Because that would cover our costs.
I want to make sure that it doesn't cost us money to.
You good with that?
There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 properties that we'd be, and then we'd set a date to the day after. And it's as is, where is, no guarantees, no nothing.
We're all with you. Get her done, please.
We give copies of everything that we have.
Thank you, Joyce.
Yeah. But I'll double check with the municipal association just to make sure that we can.
Does that have to be a motion or a consensus?
No. Just consensus.
I can give these to you. This was the query I sent, and then this is all the information that people sent back. Or I can scan it and share it with you. On the wages that.
Oh, no, I'm good with that. I believe it. Thank you. Anybody else want to
hear it? I spoke to. Maybe we should do the PD one and non-public that. Okay, that's just a real quick non-public. And the only other thing I have is at year end, when we look at all the paid time off hours, checking to make sure that both union and non-union can only carry over 60 hours into the next year. Also, we have a policy that all employees have to take a block of 40 hours off.
Minimum.
Right. And that's a an auditing thing, because you have to have someone physically removed from the job for a week so that other people are responsible for seeing what's going on. And usually that's how you can combat fraud.
Well, and I think, John, you were the most vocal last year, that no exceptions, and we've been very vocal about the department heads managing this time.
Are we talking about an email or?
What email? And making sure that they use it.
We have a public?
What email?
A letter from the department head.
Yes.
What are we talking about? Is that what we're talking about?
This, because this individual, well, you can read it.
No, I read it and I got another one. He sent it twice.
Yes, he sent it.
I mean, I certainly feel the person, but it is what it is. There's, you know, can't make an exception for him and not other people.
But it was a,
Disagree.
Because it was a weather emergency.
So January through December, he couldn't have.
Major problem.
That's a time off?
We asked 3 months ago that every department head look into the accruals.
Excuse me, I must go upstairs, they don't have a form. So we'll take over.
What I'm going to request, Catherine, is that we're gonna discuss this in non-public, because I have a few things to say.
Call me now.
That's Josie.
I'll be back.
Or no, Gail said let's do all the non-publics at once.
Just to get the board's consensus to go ahead and send a letter to that individual about the grant of pressure. Oh, yeah. That's not, that's.
And that's all I have for you?
And we finalized the open enrollment. I think it went pretty well. It kind of drags on for too long. There's still one person that never sent anything in, but I don't think they're changing anything. But we're all done, and the only difference is one employee was not taking any dental, but now he's doing a two-person dental. And that's the only one. We have more people using the FSA account.
But that's no cost to the town, two-person dental.
For the single list, because last year we didn't budget for him. But there was another one, yes, okay.
So there's no budget impact.
Yes.
Right.
And we didn't pick up any more SOS people. We're still at the same number there, but we did increase the number of FSAs, flexible spending accounts. And everybody understood, I thought it was gonna be some blowback, but everybody understood that the healthcare reimbursement amount decreased to 40%. And I did see an increase in the amounts that people are using in the FSA to cover for that, and that they know that come in 2019, close to 25%. So far I've had good feedback from people. There, you know, people had questions about, they didn't know how much was left in this account or that account, and they had that information for the FSA, but now having the healthcare reimbursement being done through Health Trust, they'll also have access to that. And that come October, I'm gonna owe you guys some money, and I want you to have a party with the money for my FSA, because they wouldn't let me split it over 43 weeks. I have to do it over 52 weeks. So my last check, make sure that whatever I hadn't already had deducted, just take that from me and you guys can.
Unless you overspend it beforehand.
Oh, they don't let you. They don't let you. Once you elect your amount, if you go over a penny, you get notified, and you've got to pay it back.
Oh, I was thinking, if you're, let's say you're going to be putting away $2,000 for the whole year, in January, you spend the whole $2,000.
Right, I'm going to pay you.
You could always, you know, use all of your whole $2,000 even though you haven't paid in yet.
Right, and then the town would be left holding the bag. I would not let the town. No, we didn't.
You couldn't figure out.
I tried, and they said no. They had the head guy email me and say, you can't do it that way.
We'll invite her to the party.
So that's all I have.
Most carpet party.
You have other things for me?
Selectmen's reports, do we have anything, John? I just have one that I've gotten several. You got it? Great. several phone calls this week on the condition of the sidewalks, complaining on the condition of the sidewalks, and they're concerned that they're not going to be cleared by the time school children are open on Tuesday. Main Street, it's snow-covered ice, is what it is. Along Main Street, and if you go up by Lockmere, it's even worse.
Are they using a plow? They're using a plow. Do we have a snowblower for that new multi-one?
Mm-hmm. Of course.
Then why are they using the plow attachment?
Using both.
It depends on your storm conditions, I think.
Because...
And the depth. If it's only a couple inches with the blower, I don't know.
Because when they use the plow, they're not clinkers, but I call them clinkers, roll back into the sidewalk, and they don't seem to get as much cleared with the plow.
The only other thing is I spent about an hour and a half last night in dispatch with Nicole, the new person, and it was absolutely amazing to see in just a short time that they've been there, the improvements that they've made to dispatch. And I think I can say this in public about the code.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
So when the night shift going out to do businesses and check on them, they would radio as each one in as they would go. Well, the public that have radios would also know where they were. So now they've devised a coding system that it's a code. Instead of, you know, BJ's, it's a code now, so they don't know. It could be at one end and this end or that end or that one. And it was all done, it's all there, the cops all know. They all the officers know, they have them in their vehicles. It's amazing to see them call in and say, you know, da-da-da, boom. I said, what was that? Oh, that's a check for this one. I looked it up, and there it was. It was really amazing. Nice to see that next level of expertise. Anyway, Selectman's reports.
People
are going to knock up. You're the next,
everybody else
said
nothing.
No, I'm good.
I had a quickie. The end of Morrison Ave, typical problems with the snow plowing, and they keep piling the snow up because Morrison, you have to come up a hill without, you could not see any, you know, when you pulled out at all until you were at least 4 to 6 feet out into the road. And
jeez.
It was getting pretty bad. I called the chief up and took care of the whole thing for me, and he'll probably tell you more how what he did with it. But and I think did Brock go down there or somebody?
Is that the state's plowing or our?
No, this would be the person who plows canine clipping, continually plows the parking lot and leaves it right there.
Okay.
So you cannot see out.
No, that's bad.
Yeah, even on a real nice summer day, it can be a little dangerous, you know, popping out there. Oh, did you try pulling out?
Oh, yeah.
Scary.
I just sat there.
So, thank you.
You're welcome. Back.
And a lot of the residents.
It shouldn't happen anymore because I talked to them and talked to the owner and all of that.
Yeah, a lot of times people don't realize when they're popping it. Thanks.
Personnel, public safety, and sale and lease of property. So those three items that we're talking about.
Motion for the non-public is for 91A.
Is that? Phone 3.
3.
C is personnel.
Matters to discuss in public or like the reputation of
public. And personnel.
Second.
Personnel.
Bog, yes.
Constantino, yes.
St. John, yes.
Scanlon, yes.
Dawson, yes. Okay.
We are red, red is on.
Motion to seal the minutes of the non-public session as pertains to personnel and safety permanently and as pertains to the other topics until they've been resolved.
Second, Fogg, yes.
Dawson, yes.
Constantine, yes.
St. John, yes.
Scanlon, yes.
Anything else to come before us in a public session?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Aye, aye.
Aye, aye.
Thank you. So, you didn't get a pet.
And to all, a good night.
I was gonna say, happy New Year.
Happy New Year.